In this video, we'll show you how to style an element based on how a user can interact with it or has already interacted with it. In order to do this, we will need to use states. Common examples include, but are not limited to, changing the background color of a button when a user hovers over it, adding shadows to an element that is being dragged on the page, highlighting the active link in a navigation menu, or graying out inputs that are disabled. Like I said, these are just a few examples. There are many more things you can do with states. Let's have a look at a real life example. Here we have a design where users can create three types of tickets: sales questions, product feedback, or bugs. In order to remind them what form they're on, we will style which option is active differently. In our design, we can see two styles. One where active is true and one where active is false. The default state is pretty much black and white and a little bit grayish. The active state, by contrast, is mostly blue with a slight, very light gray as a background color. If you're using Figma, you can see these two variants in the design tab if you are the owner of or have editing access on the project, and you can see the component properties here, active, false, or true. If you don't have editing access, you are not owner of the file, you will always be able to go to the inspect tab, and on the card, you can see the style and you can see the component property. But that's very specific to Figma, so let's not focus too much on this. Instead, let's go to WeWeb. In WeWeb, we added three checkbox elements, one for each type of ticket. The reason we chose the checkbox element is that it allows us to embed a container. So here we have a flexbox where we were able to add the two texts to match our design in Figma. We could have used the radio button element, but we would have had to sacrifice the second text. Or we could have built this entirely from scratch, but then we would not have had access to the component variables that come by default with the checkbox elements. So when you select the checkbox, it updates to true. And this is inbuilt, comes by default, so we can just drag and drop the checkbox and not have to worry about it. This is important because the style that you see here when the checkbox is checked comes from a state. So if we go on the checkbox itself, we can see that there's a checked state. This checked state is activated when the checkbox value is true. This is why you see a blue circle icon when the checkbox value is true. Now let's add our own custom state on the parent container to match our design in Figma. So to make sure that we have these blue borders. So on my checkbox, I'm going to create a state that I will call active. And the condition will be my sales question checkbox is true. In Figma, if I select the active state, I need primary 701 pixel borders. So one pixel is right, and here I will use this. Let's see if this works. So I will watch for my variable for sales question. If it's true, the borders should be blue. If it's not true, yes, they should revert back to gray. Okay, perfect. Now, how do I make sure that the text is also blue? In my design, the text is also blue when the state is active. I have primary 700 and primary 600. So in WeWeb, the best way to do this is on the parent container, so the checkbox, the parent checkbox container that has the flexbox that contains the text as children. If on this state, on my active state, I decide to apply the state to children, then when I click on the text elements, which are children elements, if I go to my states, I will have the option to select this, which is related to the active state on the parent container. And so I don't have to define conditions again. It will apply when the condition of the parent state is met. But here I can change the text color to 700. And if I do the same here, now let's see what this looks like. Works great. So that's how you add a custom state in WeWeb. You can add it to any element. Make sure to define a condition so that the state is true or false. And you can apply this state to children elements so that children elements inherit the parent state. Now, states are useful to build pleasant user experiences. Let's go a bit further and add some front-end logic to improve our UX even more. Thanks to states, we were able to style our checkboxes differently depending on whether they were active or not. However, our user experience is still not ideal because I can have no selected options, or I can select all options at the same time or several at the same time, which is not what we want. We want users to choose at least one option, but only one option, so that we know which form to display below, which input fields to display below. In order to do that, we're going to have to add a little bit of front-end logic. Let's first make sure that our users can only select one option at a time. In editing mode, I will go on one of my checkboxes. I will make sure in the navigator that I'm on a checkbox element. And I will add a workflow, which will trigger on change, so when the user interacts with the checkbox. And what I'll do is I'll reset the component variables of the other checkboxes, the ones that the user did not just interact with. So I'll choose the action reset variable. And in this case, because I'm in the sales question checkbox, I will reset the product feedback checkbox and the bug checkbox. What this will do is reset the variable values to their default value, which is false. So let's say, for example, that I selected all three. If I go back to my variables, I look, they're all true. But now if I click on sales question, those two variables should revert back to false. Let's see. Yes. So I will do the same thing on product feedback. I will trigger workflow that resets the component variables of the other checkboxes. So in this case, sales question and bug, and the same on the bug checkbox, this time updating or resetting, I should say, the sales question component variable and the product question component variable. So now in preview mode, I should only be able to select one item at a time, one option at a time, because whichever one I select, it resets the other two variables to false. Okay, that's great. That's another good step towards a good user experience. Now we need to make sure that the user has to select at least one option. So it's not possible for them to unselect an option without selecting another. In order to do this, again, I will go to editing mode, this time in settings. And here on the read-only property, I will add a little bit of logic. So I will say, if my sales question component is true, then it should be read-only, true. Or otherwise, if the checkbox value of the sales question is false, then I don't want read-only. I want to be able to update to click on the checkbox. Let's see what that does. So now I can, it's selected. I cannot unselect it. Let me show you again on product feedback. So we have this property which expects a true or false value. So we can use an if statement. If the product feedback value is true, then we want the read-only option to be enabled. So we want it to be true. Otherwise, we want it to be disabled. So false. In this case, currently, it is false. So you see it is not checked. Now we'll do the same thing on bugs. If true, false. There we go. And now we should be able to only select one item and not be able to unselect the item if it has already been selected. So what this is doing here is that because the sales question value is true, this entire checkbox is in read-only mode and I'm not able to interact with it. I can only interact with checkboxes that are not in read-only, where the read-only property is off, so false. That's it. That's how you can work with custom states in WeWeb to create beautiful and smooth user experiences.